You have to know prosody. You have to know versification. Why? Why would you have to know the science of poetry? Why would a mujtahid have to know poetry? Allah says, مَا عَلَمْنَهُ الشَّعْرُ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. We didn't teach him poetry, and it's not appropriate for him to use it. Why would you have to know poetry? Allahu Akbar. That's exactly why. Because most of what we know about the meanings of the Arabic word come from Jahili poets. The Quran is explained through the poetry of the Jahili Arabs. And if you don't understand, they knew it just by what's called sadiya or sariqa. They just knew it because they were Arabs. And they knew when a verse was wrong. We don't know that anymore. So we have to learn what's called arud. We have to learn the qawafi. We have to learn the different abhur, you know, the different metered ways, so that we can know whether it's a sound piece of poetry or not. Philology, you have to know ishtiqaqat, you have to know where roots come from, because philology is a very important science in interpreting the Quran. Combined with those of usul and rhetoric, he also has to master. You have to know balagha. And you say, well, sahaba didn't know balagha. Absolutely not. They knew balagha 100%. They didn't have words for it. But they knew when something was rakik. They knew when it was weak. And this is why the Arabs said about the Prophet ﷺ that not only did he speak to every tribe in their native dialect, if the Yemenis came, he spoke in the most rhetorically effective manner in that native dialect. That's how he was described by his own companions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the Yemenis came, not only did he speak in their dialect, he spoke in the most rhetorically powerful way that could be done in that dialect. So in other words, if you're living in the United States, I mean, television's kind of wiped this out, but traditionally you had dialects in regions. And what that would mean is, if somebody from the South came to me, I would start speaking to him in his language, not in a way that's affected to where they would feel like he's making fun of me. It would be in a way that they would feel that I was one of them. That I was actually from them, because he's from the Arab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allahumma salli ala, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. There's come to you a messenger from your own self, which means all of the Arabs, with the exception of Bani Taghlib. It's the only tribe that he did not have relatives from. All the Arabs on the entire Arabian Peninsula, the Prophet had relatives from. He was connected to every single tribe, with the exception of Bani Taghlib, because they were Christian Arabs. And Allah did not place any Christian in his, their Ummiyun, because he was from the Ummiyin. And Bani Taghlib were from Ahl al-Kitab. So he was related to all of his people. And he spoke to them in a way that they felt, subhanAllah, it's like he sent him from Hinyar. You know, it's like he sent him from Bani Tamim. So it's amazing. It's a mu'jiza of the Prophet ﷺ. And he even used Ajami words with the Ajamis. Like he used Habashi, when the Habashis, he would use some words just to honor them. SubhanAllah. And then, according to the people of precision, he has to know where judgments can be found without the condition of having memorized the actual text. So the ulama say that he doesn't have to memorize all the hadith. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that if I say, oh, well, alhamdulillah, then I've got my collection of Bukhari, my collection of Muslim, my collection of Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, all these things, then can I go and do these things because memorization is not? No, you have to have studied each one of those books with a hadith master, and have isnad and ijaza, and know which is the correct bapt, because there's different bapt in the hadith. In other words, al-Bukhari, there's different riwayat that have different ashkal and things like that, and you have to know that. So you can't just buy the books. The books have to be authenticated. Like in India, where they still maintain hadith tradition, they have authenticated, certified editions of the books that are then read with a scholar. The book, they still transmit them with absolute certainty of their transmission. And then he says, and above all these that we've just mentioned, he has to be a middle rank mastery. In other words, he has to be a master and of middle stature. He can't be like average. He has to be a master which is above average, and amongst the masters he has to have middle. In other words, he can have some middle stature in his mastery, but he has to be a master, which is not average, it's above average. he has to know those matters where there's ijma', so there's ijma'at. So he has to know where everybody's in agreement. He must know things such as the condition of a single hadith, the ahad, and the mutawatir, and the aziz. He has to know the mashhur. He has to know when a hadith is ahad, because that has a hukm, as opposed to a hadith that's mutawatir, as opposed to a hadith that's aziz. They have different ahkam related to them. Furthermore, he has to know the abrogated and the abrogating. Ibn Wahbin, who's one of the strongest men of Imam al-Bukhari and a master of hadith, he said he memorized so many hadith, he became completely confused and was worried for his own deen, that he was going to go astray, until he came to Imam Malik radiallahu anhu. And then he would relate the hadith to Imam Malik and he would say, da' al-hada, khud min hada, da' al-hada, hada mansukh, hada muqayyib. You know, he would tell them, this hadith, yufassiruhu, this hadith. And he went through all the hadith until, khalas, he knew what was valid and what was no longer valid to follow. Right? And that's why Ibn Uyayna said, the hadith is madalla, it's a place where people go astray, except for the people of fiqh. They're the people. Even al-Bukhari was not a faqih. There's some debate about that. He generally follows the tabweeb of the fuqaha. But he's not considered a faqih. He was not a mushtahid. Despite the fact he memorized all those hadith, he was not, and if you look, he's not interpreting the hadith. Rare exception, he makes some ta'liq, but generally he's not, he's a transmitter. And then he has to know also under the conditions which the verses were revealed or the hadith. So there's what's called asbab al-nuzul and asbab al-wurud. Asbab al-nuzul relates to the ayat. He has to know what the circumstances were when the ayat were revealed. Asbab al-wurud means he has to know what the circumstances in the hadith. When did the Prophet ﷺ say the hadith? Because that relates to understanding the hadith in its context. And you'll be amazed when you see, because many of the hadith don't have the asbab al-wurud in them. When you read books that have the signs of asbab al-wurud, suddenly the hadith makes sense in a way that it didn't make sense before. Guarantee you. And it's just extraordinary to see that. And then Muhammad Ilish, great scholar from Al-Azhar, was asked once. Now, this is, I think, the key to this whole point that Marab al-Hajj is making. So after he tells you all this, he says, now, consider all of the above mentioned, rahimakallah, may Allah have mercy on you. Think about what he's just said. Because this is agreed upon, these conditions. This is not... And you see for yourself whether your companion, in other words, whether the person saying, no, you have to follow the book and the sunnah and not the imam. See for yourself whether he's characterized by such qualities and fulfills these conditions. And then Marab al-Hajj says, and I highly doubt it. More likely he is just pointing people to himself in his demands that the people of this age take their judgments directly from the book and the sunnah. كَمُسْتَدِلًا عَلَى نَفْسِي. He's saying, look at me. Now, that's getting into the psychology of why people do things, right? Which is, it's a painful thing, you know, to really look at what are our motivations and why are we doing things and what is this about. The Arabs say, خَارَ فِعْرَفْ. Go against the grain and people will point at you. Right? Be a maverick and people will point at you. The Sayyidina Ali once was in a masjid in Kufa and there was a qassas there. And the Sahaba hated the qassasin. People that used to tell stories, you know, that were fabrications. They were like embellished stories. And some of them were very effective, the qassasin. Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi says on his way to, I think it's Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi, on his way to Medina, he said that there was a qassas with them. He was a young man. He said he used to get up after every prayer on the journey. They were going to Medina and he used to tell these stories and he'd have everybody weeping. And he said that the people were very affected by him. And when they got to Medina, he got up after the prayer and he started to tell his story and the little children in the mosque threw sandals at him and told him to, you know, like, be quiet. And yeah, he was stricken by, you know, he said, what's going on? What? And he looked at one of the men from Medina and he said, if the little children hadn't done that, we would have been forced to do it. We don't have qassasin in the masjid of the Prophet. We don't have these people in the masjid. This is a place to learn the deen. Right? And so the Sahaba didn't like qassasin. One man was telling a story and Sayyidina Ali wasn't listening to him, he was talking to his, and one of the men said, أتعرض عن هذا؟